The nation-state, nation, refers to a social group that is linked through common descent, culture, language, or territorial contiguity. National identity, a fluid and dynamic form of collective identity members of the community believes that they are different from other groups.
Nationalism, a doctrine and political movement that seek to make a nation and basic of a political structure, especially a state.
State, an organizational structure outside other relative office holder.
Nation state, the integration of subgroup that define themselves as a nation with the organizational structure of the state.
Global flows. The nation state is specially treated by the global economy and global economic flows.
The nation state that is due but rather a dramatic increase in the capable of passing through national borders.
Universal human rights. Human rights are a global matter and that exclusive a concern of a state.
The implication is that the international community.
Liquid sovereignty. In the context of globalization, the political authority to rule or self-rule a people from a nation state, other local and transitional communities.
Independence of the nation state. The nation state by pointing to the fact migration to the United States and other countries has declined in the late and early 20th century.
Imagine community. The nation state remain important, especially in the globalization.
We need to understand that is not a natural phenomenon.
Community is clearly a much greater reality than ever before as a result of development.
Change in global nation-state relation.
Nation-state that have served to structure international and more globalization free flows, especially of an economic nature.
United Nations or UN.
What is United Nations?
United Nations is an intergovernmental organization aiming to maintain international peace and security, develop friendly relations among nations, achieve international cooperation, and be a center for harmonizing the actions of nations.
It is the most largest and most familiar international organization.
Began operation on October 24, 1945, it is an important realm for global politics.
How does the United Nations help politics?
UN peacekeeping strength is in advancing and supporting nationally owned political solutions and processes that promote stability and peace in the long term. They build trust between communities and conflict actors at the local level, linking local mediation to national political and actors.
Why is the United Nations important in globalization?
The United Nations is uniquely positioned to provide an intellectual leadership in ensuring that the advantages of economic globalization are equally shared by the world's population and that negatively affects the mitigated.
UN as a state-centric organization. The United Nations stand in opposition, at least in general, to those who argue that globalization has brought about or is bringing about the demise of the nation-state.
The United Nations is a global setting in which nation-states meet and deliberate. It is also an independent actor.
The two best-known state-based organs in the United Nations are Security Council and the General Assembly.
United Nations Security Council is responsible for the maintenance of international peace and security.
Security Council is one of the six principal organs of the United Nations, charged with ensuring international peace and security, recommending the admission of new UN members to the General Assembly, and approving any changes to the UN Charter.
What can the Security Council do?
The Security Council establishes a Security Council resolution. The Security Council can vote to extend
amend or end mission, mandate as it deems appropriate. Under Article 25 of the Charter, all UN members agree to accept and carry out decision of the Security Council.
Next is the United Nations General Assembly. Is the main deliberative, policy-making, and representative organ of the UN.
The United Nations General Assembly, or UNGA, is the main policy-making organ of the organization. Comprising all member states, it provides a unique forum for multilateral discussion of the full spectrum of international issues covered by the Charter of the United Nations.
This picture presented is the United Nations Secretariat Building. The United Nations Secretariat carries out the day-to-day work of the UN as mandated by the General.
What does the Secretariat of the United Nations do? The Secretariat carries out the substantive and administrative work of the United Nations as directed by the General Assembly, the Security Council, and the other organs. At its head is the Secretary General, who provides overall administrative guidance.
The Secretary General is the head of Secretariat, which has tens of thousands of UN staff members working at duty stations all over the world.
The Secretary General is the public face of the organization and is responsible for its office leadership and giving direction and clarity to the organization's strategic and policy development.
The United Nations can be seen as being concerned primarily with four broad areas. First, involves in military issues.
The United Nations was envisioned as a major force in managing peace and security, especially in inter-state relations.
The second area with which the United Nations is concerned involves economic issues. In this realm, the main focus has been to promote action that would lead to reduction in global inequality.
The third is environmental issue, for example, climate change and hazardous waste.
The fourth area is matters of human protection. A variety of UN-sponsored human rights treaties and agreements have sought to protect human rights around the world.
The United Nations is both a creation and creator of United States. Its name was suggested by President Franklin Delano Roosevelt.
Franklin Delano Roosevelt is the second president of the United States of America.
The United Nations Charter was adopted in San Francisco, and the organization has been housed in New York City since the 1950s. The United States has also been the largest single contributor to the United Nations.
What is United Nations UNCTAD or UNCTAD?
United Nations Conference on Trade and Development.
UNCTAD was created in 1964 by the UN General Assembly, primarily to improve the economic situation of less developed nations and to improve their relationship with the developed nations.
UNCTAD is the main authority of the General Assembly in the sphere of trade and development. Its purpose is promotion of trade and development, particularly in developing countries.
UNCTAD is also a part of the United Nations Secretariat, dealing with trade, investment, and development issues.
United Nations Educational, Scientific, and Cultural Organization, or UNESCO.
With headquarters in Paris, UNESCO has been in existence since 1946. Its primary focus in the areas of education, the natural and social sciences, and culture.
The main objective of UNESCO is to contribute peace and security in the world by promoting collaboration among nations through education, science, culture, and communication in order to enhance universal respect for justice, for the rule of law, and for the human rights and fundamental freedoms which are affirmed for.
My topic is all about global governance. Global is involving the whole or entire world. While governance refers to the process and institutions, formal or informal, whereby rules are created, compliance is elicited, and goods are provided in pursuit of collective goals. Governance means the way a group of people, such as a country, do things. It is also the rules of political system to solve conflicts between actors and adopt decisions. Legal pluralism means the situation in which two or more legal systems coexist in the same social field. Global governance is the decline of the nation-state, along with at least some of its governance functions and the fact that intergovernmental organizations, or IGUs, like the United Nations in treaties like the Kyoto Protocols have not been sufficient in solving transnational issues have given rise to proliferating forms of global governance, which means to provide global goods, particularly peace and security, justice and mediation systems for conflict functioning markets, and unified standards for trade and industry. For example, the financial market regulation through the Bank for International Settlements, norms and rules. Governance has shaped global politics in important ways in this rapidly growing area of both activity and research. There are at least three new forms of global or transnational governance. First, the governance through multi-stakeholders initiative. Second, global governance involves the creation of voluntary regulations. Third, there are transnational arbitration bodies. Governance through multi-stakeholders initiatives, which brings together various public and private actors into public policy networks and partnerships. It usually involves at least one state actor and various international institutions, as well as NGOs and private sector organizations of various sorts. Multi-stakeholders initiatives provide governance in the form of service provision, for example, the Global Fund to Fight AIDS, Tuberculosis, and Malaria, industrial standards, for example, the World Commission on Dams, and labor standards in global value chain. Which means voluntary partnership or collaboration between government, businesses, civil society, and the private sectors. The most common form of global governance involves the creation of voluntary regulations. In voluntary regulatory system, MNCs or other actors agreed to a set of social and environmental practices that go beyond the stated or enforced set of laws in the area and in which they operate. Sometimes, these standards are created directly by the companies in a given sector. For example, a code of conduct, and are little more than public relation tools. This is where the setting or creation of rules and laws in which an actor operates. But in other cases, the standards are developed, monitored, and enforced through an extensive network of international organizations. For example, NGOs, social movement organizations, states, IGOs, and etc. One example of this voluntary form of regulation is the Forest Stewardship Council, or FSC, which seeks to promote sustainable forestry. FSC brings together environmental and social NGOs, forestry corporations, and scientific institutions in the development of forestry standards that are monitored and enforced through independent third-party certification. Many of these private regulatory schemes rely on mobilizing consumers to purchase certified products and punishing those companies that do not submit to this voluntary regulation. Not all systems of voluntary regulation feature a specific set of standards that are monitored and enforced. For example, the Global Compact, created by former UN Secretary General Kofi Annan, encompasses 10 basic principles by which businesses around the world should voluntarily conduct their affairs, in which facilitates learning and capacity building in the development and implementation of the social and environmental principles. For example, businesses should support human rights, eliminate compulsory labor, and promote greater environmental responsibility, but it is not enforced or monitored. Many forms of corporate social responsibility fall into this category. Number 3, there are transnational arbitration bodies, where global governance has been accorded to courts and lawyers, but their authority is not based in international law. The Commission's independent investigation process can establish a factual record of violations that can put pressure on states to adhere to their national laws. The World Bank has similar procedures. The authority of these arbitration bodies or info courts is based on information and persuasion, not law, or at least not any law that they have the power to enforce. These processes have led to some improvements, but they are limited in scope. One important area of governance is the world economy. There are at least 5 interdependent levels at which it can operate. Number 1. The major political entities, especially the G3, such as Europe, Japan, and North America, can govern through various agreements to stabilize exchange rates, to coordinate fiscal and monetary policies, and to cooperate in limiting speculative short-term financial transactions. Number 2. Nation-states can create various international regulatory agencies, for example, the World Trade Organization or WTO, to deal with specific economic issues. Number 3. Trade and investment blocs such as the European Union, the North American Free Trade Agreement or NAFTA, the Trans-Pacific Partnership or TPP, and the ASEAN Free Trade Area or AFTA can govern large economic areas, for example, North America, the Pacific Rim countries. Number 4. Nations can develop policies to enhance themselves and the ability to their corporations to compete in the global marketplace. Number 5. Regions within nations can integrate economic activities that take place within their borders in order to increase their ability to compete globally. And the Asian Free Trade Area or AFTA can govern large economic areas, for example, North America, the Pacific Rim country. Number 4. Nations can develop policies to enhance themselves and the ability to their corporations to compete in the global marketplace. Number 5. Regions within nations can integrate economic activities that take place within their borders in order to increase their ability to compete globally and to protect themselves from large shocks that might adversely affect them. James Rose now links this to the increasing fragmigration of the global order. Fragmigration is a contraction of the terms fragmentation and integration, refers to the diverse and contradictory forces that can be summarized in the clash between globalization, centralization, and integration on the one hand, and localization, decentralization, and fragmentation on the other. This reflects increasing global diversity as well as the array of contradictory forces that have been unleashed as a result of it. There is a series of more specific factors behind the growth in the demand for more global governance. The top of the list must be the declining power of the nation-state. If states themselves are less able to handle various responsibilities, this leaves open the possibility of the emergence of some form of global governance to fill the void. A second factor is the vast flows of all sorts of things into and often right through the borders of nation-states. This can involve the flow of digital information of all sorts through the internet. It is difficult, if not impossible, for a nation-state to stop such flows, and it is often likely that such action would be politically unpopular and bring much negative reaction. The flow of criminal elements in their products such as drugs, laundered money, and etc. is a strong factor in the call for global governance. In these cases and others, there is a need for some degree of order, some sort of effective authority, and at least some potential for the improvement of human life. Another set of issues that has led to calls for global governance involves horrendous events within nation states that are states themselves
either famine and carry out or unable to control. For example, in Syria, more than 400,000 people had been killed and 11.3 million displaced as of 2017. Amidst economic turmoil and government repression, the Syrian conflict was sparked in 2011 when citizens protested the arrest and torture of 15 boys, a 13-year-old was killed. During a peaceful protest, the Syrian government, led by President Bashar al-Assad, killed hundreds of demonstrators and imprisoned many more. A band of military defectors attempted to overthrow the government, and various groups have been vying for power ever since. The Syrian government used chemical weapons on its own people in 2013. The conflict has been the deadliest of this century so far. Of course, it is far from the only event of its kind in recent history. And there are global problems that single nation states cannot hope to tackle on their own. One, which is the global recessions, such as the Great Recession, which sweep the world periodically. Indeed, some nations, for example, the nations of Southeast Asia, have often been and are currently being victimized by such issues. Unable to help themselves, such nations are in need of assistance from some type of global governance. Nation-states have long struggled to deal with problems like this through various interstate systems. For example, alliances such as the North Atlantic Treaty Organization or NATO. But the more recent trend is toward the development of truly global structures and methods of dealing with various sorts of issues and problems. A trend that some people reject, as many citizens of the United Kingdom did when voting for Brexit.
My topic is civil society. What is civil society? It is comprised of groups or organizations working in the interest of the citizens but operating outside of the governmental and for-profit sectors. Civil society is sometimes referred to as the civil sector, a term that is used to differentiate it from other sectors that comprise a functioning society. John Keane praises that we now consider civil society to the appearance of the West on the global stage beginning around 1500 until the 19th century. Civil society was not distinguished from a state dominated by laws. The German philosopher George Wilhelm Friedrich Hegel played a key role in redefining it as that which exists between the family and the state. A realm not only separated from them, but in which an individual can participate directly in various social institutions. To Hegel, like Marx and Engels, the economy was art of civil society. The major figure in social theory associated with the idea of civil society is Alexis de Tocqueville. Tocqueville lauded the early American propensity to form a wide range of association that we are not political in nature and orientation. The distinction between the market and civil society is 20th century innovation, usually associated with the Italian Marxist thinker Antonio Gramsci. Karl Dorr accords central importance to the 1970s and 1980s, especially in Latin America and Eastern Europe. In both regions, there was opposition to military dictatorship and effort to find an autonomous and self-organizing base outside of the state in order to oppose the military. It was also during this period that civil society became increasingly global as improved travel and communication made linkage among various civil society groups increasingly possible. Following Caldor's, civil society is defined as a process through which individuals negotiate, argue, struggle against, or agree with one another and those in authority. While civility and civil society have ancient roots and examples.
Historically, civil society was nation-state centered. In more recent years, it has been associated with more global actions and therefore with a somewhat different set of organizations, including social movements, non-governmental organizations, transnational networks, religious organizations, and community groups. According to John Keane, global civil society is a global, non-governmental, pluralistic form of society composed of interlinked social processes oriented to civility. Keane gives us a good feel for global civil society. However, one of the things that sets Keane's view on civil society apart is his argument that the economic market is deeply implicated in it. While many see civil society as distinct from both the nation-state and the market, Keane puts forth the no market, no civil society rule. Keane draws three basic conclusions from this relationship. Markets are an intrinsic empirical feature, a functionally intertwined prerequisite of the social relations of actually existing global civil society. Global civil society, as we know and though experience it, could not survive for more than a few days without the market forces unleashed by turbo capitalism, and the market forces of turbo capitalism could not themselves not survive for a day without other civil society institutions. Like households, charities, community associations, and linguistically shared social norms like friendship, trust, and cooperation.
To buttress his point, Keane argues that labor is not restricted to the market economy, but is a kind of social activity also found in non-market settings, such as household and charities, arts and entertainment, recreation, intimate relationship, communications media, and sacred settings and institutions.
However, Keane also recognizes that the capitalist market can disturb, even disrupt, global civil society. True, for example, the great social inequality it produces, or by choosing where to invest and especially where not to invest, as well as where to withdraw investments.
Or perhaps, the greatest importance from a negative point of view is the tendency for the capitalist market to strengthen the hand of the market domination over the non-profit institutions of the society, which tend to push and pull, twisted and turn into bodies that obey the rules of accumulation and profit maximization.
Civil society is not a reality that is ever or could ever be completed. Rather, it is an ongoing and ever-presented project. This is especially the case in the era of globalization, when the civil societies that were created in nation states now must be extended to the global level. In fact, it could be argued that without a global civil society, the promises of the national civil society would die.
In practice, civil society has been dominated for decades by its critical agents and agencies. But more recently, neoliberalism and neoliberal groups have picked up on the idea of creating organizations, NGOs, often funded by government and international agencies, oriented to reform the market and government. Some see these NGOs as compromising the very notion of civil society and argue that they should not be thought of as a part of it.
However, as both Keane and Kaldor point out, civil society is a broad and internally contradictory category that includes a wide range of groups. A variety of movements and organizations have also come together since the 1990s to form significant components of the global civil society. One type involves various groups of transnational activists participating in efforts to deal with global warming, AIDS, landmines, and so forth. Then there is the alter-globalization movement, as well as the anti-war movement. Of growing significance in the realm of global civil society is the wide range of organizations dealing primarily with issues that relate to the environment, human rights, and economic development. Perhaps of greatest importance today in thinking about civil society are groups that represent the poor, especially those in less developed countries, and their efforts to improve the position of the poor within the global economy. That's all. Thank you for listening to my presentation.